We're meeting. I'm John, by the way.
Hi, John.
Nice to meet you.
So what can you tease us with about the next season?
I'm not sure what you've been teased with already, so I'll just say, if I'm repeating stuff, that I apologize. We're going to see a new Poison Ivy come out this year. Do you guys know about that?
Yes.
Okay. And we see the Mad Hatter is going to be coming this year and causing a great deal of havoc this year. We are going to delve into the world of the Court of Owls, and that's going to be a long arc that we're going to play throughout the course of the year. Some of which will be drawn from the canon, some of which stuff we're going to be adding to as well. And we're going to put a face on the Court of Owls in a way that I think has not been done before in the canon, so that we'll actually see people inside there who have meaning and influence inside our world. What else can I tell you? What is the teaching you guys? Certain characters who matter to our main characters are going to come back into the show as well. Oh, that's vague. Sorry. Cool things will happen.
Exactly.
Yeah. With Poison Ivy and Mad Hatter in particular, there's a lot of visual things from the comics. There's a lot of different variations of those characters.
Yep.
Can you zero in on sort of your take?
Yeah. Our take on Ivy is definitely going to be different from the Ivy of the books, because our Ivy is a mentally and emotionally still 14, 15 year old girl, but she's suddenly in the body of a 25 year old woman, so she is not quite the femme fatale that she will later on become in the comics, so she's spent a lot of time trying to find her way through that. She also doesn't have the fantastic powers that she has in the comic books. She's someone who develops, and will watch her develop her interest in plants and what they can actually do. And also, it will be a story of somebody who's actually discovering the power that they now have as they grow up and say, oh wait, now I actually have this ability to pull people in, or pull in men, and learning how to use that / abuse that. In terms of Jervis, there are so many different versions of him in the comic books, The version that we're playing of him is someone who is one of the more realistic versions, I would say. We lean as well into the version of someone who has a deep, deep, perhaps too deep love for his sister named Alice. Who he's hunting by, and his story with Alice will actually damage him in a way that he'll end up then blaming Jim for and coming after him. As well, he's someone who really is focused on it's not just straight mind control like you frequently do, but it's really about cracking open the dark heart of everybody and bringing it to life.
We did crack open a bus door at the end of the season, and interesting characters came out.
Yeah.
There's, of course, a rumor that Clarine's coming back. We saw a young Bruce Wayne. Is this Clayface, maybe? The young Bruce Wayne?
Got it. The young Bruce Wayne is not Clayface, but we definitely will see Clayface, the young Bruce Wayne is something different.
Okay. And as for Jerome?
For Jerome, I would just say, it's Gotham, you can't keep a bad man down.
The Flash is in the show, it's DC, and they've introduced multi-universes. In your mind, does the Flash exist within...
In our world?
In your world. Is there
I'm sure he exists. I don't think we're ever going to see him. But okay. I'm sure he's off there.
What can you say about the state of mind?
When he walks into the seer, he's someone who is riven with guilt and regret. And all of these things that he's done over the course of the past 2 years, and all the bad things that happened, he's basically attributed to certain decisions that he's made. So he's someone who's basically retreated at the top of the seer and saying, everything I touch seems to basically turn to lead, so I'm going to stop doing this right now. But he finds himself inevitably pulled back into the mix of things. So,
okay. Again, all right.
All right. Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.